Our next speaker is Dr. Sudarshan from Shankar Netralaya, Chennai, who's going to be talking on management of cataract in uveitic patients. On to you, Dr. Sudarshan.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for taking me into this. Can I start off?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
For some, actually including me, probably something like this in the fundus, if I see, then I get too excited. We have Srinivas here who probably gets excited over these things. So for some others, when they see the disc or things like this, then eyeball keeps moving here and there, or in the disc more and more becomes more pale, they get excited. But for most, if not all, something like this is mouth-watering. So when you have something dilated like this, NS2, PSC, then that's a breadwinner for most of us. And when you have these premium IOs, then it's topping, creaming on that. But being uveitis specialist, God smiles even at us. They give us something called Fuchs uveitic cataracts, which seem to be the easiest among all of them. So that we do the rexus, and if you get away with it, then that's fine. But not always though, you know, like say we have want to show off that we do all these complicated ones also. So for us to be smiling even after uveitic cataract surgeries, it's better we follow some preferred practice guidelines so that we don't come out dull after the surgery. So challenges in the management of uveitic cataracts, the most important thing is the control of inflammation preoperatively, and make sure the systemic status of the patient is controlled. Intraoperatively, you have a lot of things. The cornea can have BSK, the pupils, posterior synecae. You need to make the pupil better. Iris can bleed, postoperative complications. So it's important that you manage them, plan them very well. So I'll try to break it up into significant points about the preoperative assessment, intraoperative and postoperative. Preoperatively, it's better to have a to-do list. Most of the time, cataract may not be the only cause of vision loss, but make sure that cataract is also contributing to vision loss. You have PAM, ultrasound, UBM, which can decide about things. Make sure that the physician fitness is taken. Plan the additional procedures. But the most important thing among everything about the preoperative management is about the disease activity. It's important to have at least 2 to 3 months inflammation-free period with or without maintenance therapy. Like some people have a feeling that, okay, you'll have to get back the steroid to zero and then only continue it as disease-free activity. Inflammation-free period is very important. Adequate perioperative cover, preferably oral steroids, or in addition, subcutaneous can be given. Antiviral, if at all the patient is a prior viral uveitic patient, antiviral cover is must, but ATD antitoxo is not mandatory. Steroid cover, we usually give oral steroids. We increase in the perioperative period along with or sometimes without subtenons. If the patient says of weak age or sympathetic ophthalmia where the patient is on immunomodulators or biologicals, then it has to continue. Ozurdex is a very good option. It's an alternate option. Currently, we've been, the numbers are definitely better than before. The best thing they say is about 2 weeks prior, but it's about two procedures. Adequate inflammatory effect is there at the time of surgery, but the problem is if you have a rent or anything, the Ozurdex comes up into the AC. So intraoperative Ozurdex is the best option probably, logistically speaking. It's a single procedure. Steroid effect lasts in the postoperative period also. But remember that it has to be in select situations. Unilateral intermediate uveitis or systemic contraindication for oral steroids, that's a good option. But whenever there's an underlying systemic disease, it's always better to have a systemic steroid cover. So how mandatory is this? So something like JIA, where the longer the better of inflammation-free period, even a few years is better. VKH, sympathetic ophthalmia, or HLA-B27, all these things, it's very mandatory. But something, some uveitis which is old heel choroiditis, or even Fuchs, you can probably get away without a steroid cover or without the mandatory one, and they can decide postoperatively. But don't delay surgery in lens-induced uveitis or associated glaucoma, or where you need RD surgery. This is one patient where it was ARN, and progressively the lens haze started becoming more, and we couldn't follow up the patient also so fast. So where you need to visualize and manage the posterior segment pathology, plan it up early. Intraoperatively, the most important thing is the pupil size and the capsule. Have adequately sized and retained pupil during surgery. That's the most important one. You can do it with many things. You can either probably use a Cuke lens if you can get away with a moderate sized pupil, or if you have have minor sphincter tears and continue with it. If you, most of us use Grisha burrs, because it, although it can tint up the iris, it can definitely have a retained larger sized pupil. Nowadays, off late, I've been a big fan of Suven's BHEX ring. So most of the time, if it's a moderate sized pupil, I think when you start growing, you start becoming less bold, and then even moderate sized pupils, you want some kind of retainer. And ease of use, insertion and removal is easier. The false chamber, shallowing of the anterior chamber is not there in BHEX rings. Ultimately, it is, you need to individualize which one is better for you. UVT capsules are soft, friable, and they easily run. Strain it whenever it's required, when it is total cataract or when the glow is even more, something like this is a sunset glow of a VKH. Capsular phimosis chances are lesser if you make a large size capsular excess, because in UVT case, phimosis chances are higher and can tilt or displace the IOL. Staining capsule doesn't stain your image, remember that. You can have an intermittent cataract in Fuchs, remember the flag sign. You need to decompress it, and if you are comfortable, I use the Kimura's most of the time than a Uttarata. It's not always that capsules are so friable. Sometimes it can even be fibrous and membranous like this. It can be very thick. You need to puncture it, cut it with the varnas, and do it away with it. You can even continue using cutting it or extending the rexus after using the IOL also. Phaco is relatively easy. Not in all patients it is harder, except in something like Hansen's or elderly granulomatous. But remember that endothelial protection has to be there. Intraocular lens, preferably acrylic in the bag. Single piece in the sulcus, never. Peripheral iridectomy, I don't do it routinely, but in patients at risk of glaucoma or in shallow eyes, then you can probably do a peripheral iridectomy. It's not over till it's over. That's what they say. Postoperatively, last few slides. Monitor the IOP and inflammation. The postoperative steroids need to be continued. And be aware of the complications such as the post-op fibrin, IOL, cystoid macular edema. Most importantly, manage the primary disease. That's most important. The cataract surgery is over. It doesn't mean that's the end of the thing for the patient. Uveitic disease has to be managed primarily. So to conclude, uveitic cataracts need special attention. The preoperative period, inflammation-free period is a must. Varies accordingly. The longer it is, the better. But in children, it's better that you plan the amblyopic part of it also. Intraoperative Ozurdex is an alternate option in select situations. IOL in the bag, acrylic, heterophobic gives the best results. And most importantly, to repeat, manage the primary entity after the surgery also. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sudarshan. Dr. Atul Kumar, you are there? Dr. Lalit Verma?
Yeah, I am here. One question I wanted to ask.
Sudarshan. I wanted to ask a question to you, Dr. Lalit, first.
Let me ask first to Sudarshan, because I have already planned that. After hearing his rapid fire talk, such fast and so much information, what is your take on putting Ozurdex at the time of UVT cataract surgery?
Yes, so off late we've been using a few of them, like compared to the surgery which we do with oral steroid cover, Ozurdex and the Phaco is much lesser, definitely. But in patients who've had a long-standing remission, who don't seem to be reacting that badly, especially in the milder UVT cataracts like intermediate UVTs or unilateral ones, Ozurdex is a better option.
If it is a case of a juvenile idiopathic arthritis, now how would you prevent secondary cataract formation more than some more points than what you've already said?
Actually, the last couple of slides were about pediatric UVT cataracts. I just deleted it just before I started off. Most important thing is in GIA, we need to actually have a larger inflammation-free period. So the most important thing among them is what we have seen. We have a study where the adolescent age group seem to be doing much better than the younger age group. But earlier immunosuppressive therapy is better. Avoiding topical steroids are better. These things prevent early cataract formation in GIA surgery
debates. I have a question.
Do a posterior capsular excess and a little bit of anterior vitrectomy also?
PPC, we opt for PPC, especially if the child is less than 6 or 7 years old. When it is yaggable or like when they can be cooperative for YAG, then probably we don't need to do a PPC. Anterior vitrectomy, like not always we need to do, that's what I feel. Because in PPC, the aim is to have a clear visual access.
Sir, in case of non-infectious uveitis or GIA, who's going for a pediatric cataract, then how early you start the systemic steroids in these cases? And secondly, if the patient is diabetic, then would you prefer going for oral steroid and increasing the insulin or going for any methods like PST injection or intravitreal IVTA or intravitreal dexamethasone?
The first part is about the GIA. When the inflammation is active, then probably that is the time we need to give oral steroids or systemic steroid therapy. But simultaneously, GIA is a primary immunosuppressive therapy indication. So if at all one GIA and BSS are two diseases where you need to give biologicals or your threshold for biologicals is much lower. But immunomodulators like methotrexate works very well. So So start off with methotrexate simultaneously along with steroids in conjunction with the rheumatologist. So and take off the steroids as early as possible so that the disease is under control with immunomodulators. And in for the second, diabetics with steroids, diabetics with cataracts and uveitis, that's what depends on the primary uveitic disease. If it's weak or base or sympathetic ophthalmia, they really act very badly postoperatively. The chances of complications are much higher. So in that case, it's okay to use insulin, reduce it. Maybe you can reduce the dosage of oral steroids, add a PST for it. But have perioperative steroid cover always. Postoperatively, inflammation is lesser, you can stop steroids.
Can I make a comment?
Yes, doctor.
Basically, uveitic cataract with hypotony would be a very big challenge. And in such cases, UVM may be required. And if there is a lot of cyclotic membrane, one may do, instead of cataract extraction, one may need to do a vitrectomy and remove the fractions and membranes. So that is one of the options.
One of the slides that went like lightning was that slide, sir, actually. Like whether you need to decide about phaco or lens switch.
Have to go on to our next speaker. Thank you.